This podcast is a part of the Podmania Podcasting Network. Check out podmania.co.uk to check out more of our great podcasts, features, reviews, match ratings and previews spanning the crazy and diverse world of professional wrestling.
What's up, everybody, and welcome to another episode of Wrestling with Johnners. This is episode 91, and today we're going to be focusing on day one of New Japan Pro Wrestling's Wrestle Kingdom 14. And this took place live from the Tokyo Dome on Saturday, the 4th of January 2020. And we've got Kurt Johansson on the line, who's going to be helping us cover day one of Wrestle Kingdom 14. So good morning, Kurt. How you doing, buddy?
Morning, mate. Yeah, really good. We've just watched Wrestle Kingdom Night 2. Really looking forward to speaking about night one with you, and all going well, and really happy to be back on Wrestling with Johnners.
Yeah, fantastic. It's been a few months since we last had you on board. I think your last appearance was our anniversary edition, wasn't it?
So yeah,
I think
that's
that was
correct.
Episode 75 or 6. But that was a really good episode. We had an Ask Johnners special there, and that was the first time that Kurt's been on the pod, and this is his second time on the Wrestling with Johnners podcast. So great to have you back on board. Can't wait to hear your thoughts on Wrestle Kingdom 14 day one. It was a hell of a day, hell of a show. Like I say, we just got done watching day two. We're not going to let out any spoilers if possible about day two. We'll try and keep that under wraps. But day one was an amazing show. But before we get into all the happenings from Wrestle Kingdom 14 day one, I just want to kind of urge all my listeners and any of Kurt's fans or listeners to go and check out the new Wrestling with Johnners website, wrestlingwithjohnners.com, where you can find all of our social media links, our archive to all of our podcasts, our vlogs, all of our interviews, and daily news updates from around the wrestling world, and exclusive articles from my team of writers. So go and check that out. That's www.wrestlingwithjohnners.com. Like I say, you can find all of our social media links at the top of the page, so I don't need to read them out to you at the top of every episode anymore. Just go to the website and it's all there in one nice tidy package. But first of all, Kurt, before we get stuck into Wrestle Kingdom 14, like I say, it's been a couple of months since we last spoke to you, but almost immediately after kind of hanging up the Skype call to you, some big things happened, and you didn't let anything out on the podcast, or you may have alluded to it, but you've got your own podcast, Kurt's Angles, out and about now. So obviously you're part of the Ringsider podcast team, but I think in the back of your mind you had kind of thoughts on setting up your own podcast, and you delivered that a couple of weeks after we spoke with Kurt's Angles, and your first episode was an amazing interview with Thunder Rosa, tell us a little bit about your new podcast, Kurt's Angle, and your chat with Thunder Rosa then, buddy.
Thank you, John. So to be fair, it wasn't anything that I alluded to initially. I didn't have a plan to set up my own podcast, to be honest. I think it was after I'd spoken to you, and a few days prior I'd been on Badlands with Mags and Paul, and I just really enjoyed it. And as much as I love my Ringsiders boys, I was just thinking, you know what, I'm gonna do something where I can do it at my own leisure when I'm at home, something that's just mine, and I can play around a little bit without potentially hindering the Ringsiders brand. I'm going to be trying some new interesting concepts to shows, and it's been a name that's been put to me for quite a while. I've had various different people saying that I should do my own show called Kurt's Angle, and eventually I gave in. I was like, you know what, it's happening. So it wasn't anything I planned. It was, I think, 3 or 4 days after speaking to you is when I'd announced it, and it was all a last minute thing. At the time, I had no experience graphic designing, so I'd got the fiance to create the initial Kurt's Angle logo, and in the past 3 months I've just been teaching myself how to design graphics, which I seem to be getting hand off pretty quickly and pulling out some decent stuff. And Yeah, my first episode. I couldn't have debuted any better, to be honest, with La Mira Mira, Thunder Rosa. We'd spoken about throughout her career how she got into the business. She didn't really grow up as a fan, to say. We spoke about her time with Lucha Underground and Women of Wrestling. Her, at the time, recent debut in National Wrestling Alliance and her MMA debut in Combatants America. So it was a really good chat. She was just so humble and one of my favourite interviews I've ever done. And I thought it was like a great platform for me to kick off the brand.
It really was a hot start, definitely. And where can my listeners find your podcasts? And I know you're on YouTube as well as various podcasting platforms, kind of on Spotify and all the usual platforms, I'm guessing, Kurt?
Yeah, so Spotify, I imagine it'll be on iTunes. I'm using Anchor quite a lot. But one of the things I've been doing is YouTube. I'm trying to get some more video content or to put a background to the audio. I might be making some like graphics and things like that. So You can find me on our new website at ringsiders.co.uk. We've got podcasts on there. So it'll be the Umbrella Podcast with Ringsiders. Then there's myself with Kurt Sangle. And then Jamie and Callum have followed suit. So Jamie's now doing Bell to Bell. His last name is Bell. So again, another nice little podcast name there. And then Callum's going to be doing a show based on NXT called Talking Takeover. And yeah, you can find me on YouTube. YouTube's probably my priority upload at the moment. I've just felt it's where I'm getting the best traffic. So just put Kurt's Angle Podcast in YouTube. And so far, you'd be able to check out the first three episodes of Kurt's Angle. Obviously, a month ago, Thunder Rosa. The second one, I spoke to the Queen of NE. We did the story so far on Wednesday Night Wars, speaking about AEW and NXT. And within, I think it was like the first nine weekly shows. And then my latest one was what I alluded to earlier with the trying different concepts that may not work. And this one's called Kurt's Angle, where I'm doing one more match. So I'll speak to guests. I'll tell them to think of a female, a male, and a tag team. And they've got to say, like, where their match will be, who will it be against. And I try and get the thinking brains going to give me some insight why they'd want that match to happen. And that the first episode included the Queen of NE, Jamie and Callum from Ringsiders, and NXT UK superstar Travis Banks.
Yeah, so just skipping ahead a little bit there, and then shout out to the Queen of NE. Had her on the podcast for the SummerSlam Survivor Series review a couple of months ago. But Travis Banks, now, not long after speaking to us on the anniversary edition of the Wrestling with Jonas podcast, you went to the NXT UK tapings in Hull, and you were involved in a WWE press event, which I think is a first for you, where you were able to interview Travis Banks. But I understand you was also interviewed by the son of Big Daddy Earl Crabtree for a BBC show that's going to be coming out later on this year. So tell us about being invited, how you managed to get yourself into a WWE press event and how that went. You obviously had a chat with Travis Banks and then the BBC thing with Earl Crabtree.
So the Travis Banks thing, it came up about 3-4 days before the event. Initially, my first episode, I was supposed to have the Queen on, and I had to push that back because I needed to do this Travis Banks interview. And we'd reached out to the WWE press event, we gave them our socials, they could see our huge Twitter following. And after speaking to Callum, who had been great at being contacting with the press office, he was like, look, I'll be there, but I want you to deliver it. I think you'd be the best person to do the interview, without much preparation or with quick thinking. I am quite good at that. He sat in on an interview I did with Chris Ridgway. Unfortunately, the audio was damaged for that eventually, but he really enjoyed that. So, yeah, the shows were Friday and a Saturday. The press interview was Saturday morning. I think it was probably the only time I ironed a shirt that year. so yeah, it was really good. I was quite nervous, and I think that's a good thing. If you're not nervous, you don't care enough. And
exactly, yeah.
Being a lifelong WWE fan, and I think I even put it on my personal social media on Facebook about like what that weekend was for me, because a lot of people may not understand. If they don't get wrestling, they don't understand why I'm doing a podcast. They don't understand any of it. And then from what they thought was a hobby and like potentially a waste of time, it's made me do my first interaction with WWE on an official basis, which was just an incredible experience. And
bit of a dream come true, I'm sure.
Yeah, and hopefully it's just the start of things to come. Hopefully yeah. I can get involved with more press interviews with WWE and other companies. We're constantly working on trying to make our brand better, bigger. And yeah, the Earl Crabtree one was quite surreal. It was on the Friday. And again, I didn't know this was happening until 5 seconds before it happened. So it wasn't something I could prepare for. We were just in the lobby and we saw Earl Crabtree, so we'd gone over and was just speaking to him and things like that. And then a TV crew came up and was like, can we interview you guys for, it's called Inside Out.
Yeah.
Here in the UK, it's across all the BBC channels, and it's for Inside Out in Yorkshire and Lincolnshire. And was like, yeah, sure. So it led to just getting asked various different questions, and I believe I was speaking about like why the British wrestling scene's so big now, and that basically because something that was so unattainable has become attainable and achievable for so many people, and it's pushing people to be better and work harder essentially. And yeah, it came across really well. I'd spoken to Earl afterwards, and he ended up following me on my social media, so I guess I can't have done too bad of a job. And I believe that's supposed to be airing in February when they're covering the local wrestling, where we'll be about NXT UK in Hull. And yeah, it'll be interesting what gets used on that show.
Amazing. Absolutely amazing. A great story. And like I say, just by chance, you got pulled into an interview that's going to air across BBC. And working at a WWE press event is simply an amazing kind of series of events all in one night. But congratulations on setting up your new podcast, and wish you all the best of luck with that and the Ringside crew, of course. And I've got Jamie and Callum on the Wrestling with Jonas podcast in the coming weeks, helping me to cover all the latest stuff with AEW and NXT, so I'm looking forward to speaking to them. But today we're here to speak about Wrestle Kingdom then, Kurt. So I know that you're a big New Japan Pro Wrestling fan. Yeah. Admittedly, I dip in and out occasionally. I definitely watch all the big shows, definitely watch all the Wrestle Kingdoms, but looking forward to covering day one with you. So I mean, it's the single biggest show of the year outside of WrestleMania, with matches that will blow any other company's matches out of the water, to be honest with you. I don't think there's been a WrestleMania that can quite live up to the calibre of what New Japan can pump out on some of their big shows. But in a first for Wrestle Kingdom, it's going to be spread over 2 days. You obviously had day one on the 4th of Jan, day two today, which took place literally minutes ago, Sunday the 5th of Jan, from the Tokyo Dome. And what were your thoughts when the news came out that it was going to be spread over 2 days then, Kurt? Because we've traditionally seen it, like I say, the first week or the first weekend of every new year for the last 13 years on one day. And it's normally a big 4 or 5 hour extravaganza, fantastic matches, so much talent. To have the same show over 2 days, what were your thoughts when that was first announced?
I was in the middle, to be honest. Like, I was thinking, does it really need to be 2 days? Like, are they going to have enough matches to fill two shows without having filler matches? And then they announced this double champion thing that they was doing, and I was like, okay, this will work.
Yeah.
Because you're going to have the contenders fight on the first one, and then essentially the final in the main event of night two. And I like that, but I don't know how it'd work continuing in the future. Like, could it decrease the quality of one show? I think it does. I think it makes Wrestle Kingdom from start to finish would never have a piss break match or anything like that. The quality is stacked like from start to finish, and the quality is still there, and there's some absolutely fantastic matches. And I'm sure it's something we'll get into shortly, and we spoke about previously, these like 8-man tag matches that we had at the start of night one. When I've had 3 hours sleep and I've just woken up, that stuff's going to put me back to sleep. It kind of took it away from me, those first, like, well, the second and third match, I don't think needed to be on the show. But it's great for Japanese wrestling. I've seen all over social media all the different companies like Noah, you've got DDT, Big Japan Pro, Toshijo Pro, Stardom. They're all being benefiting from this being across 2 days. A lot of them have been running in Cork and Hall. So for Japanese wrestling as a whole, I think it's a great thing, and I think it might draw more traveling fans with it being a weekend, because they're not just going for that one day.
It's more of an event.
Yeah, it'd be like a WrestleMania weekend, essentially, for Japan.
Definitely, yeah. And good for business for New Japan, because I think they sold out the Dome on night one with over 40,000 spectators. And they did similar business on night two with about 30,000 plus spectators for night two. So 70,000 New Japan fans watching Wrestle Kingdom over the course of 2 nights. I'd say it must be good business for New Japan. But I thought that the two shows combined were very, very solid, to be honest with you. And there was some very, very good highlights and one or two kind of minor nitpicky lowlights that we'll talk about. But there's so many good matches, especially, you know, with the current IWGP champion, Kazuchika Okada, defended his title on night one against the G1 Climax winner, Kota Ibushi, which is going to be one of the highlights of night one that we're going to talk about. The winner of that match will go on to face the winner of Jay White, the Intercontinental Champion, versus Naito in the double gold dash on night two, the main event of night two, to see who will walk out with all the gold. And it will be the first ever double champion in New Japan's history, I understand. One of the other highlights, some might not see this as a highlight, but it's also the final two matches in the retirement of Jushin Thunder Liger, who's had a 30-year plus career. And it'll be no doubt very emotional for everybody, you know, on both nights, whether they be in the ring with them, in the arena, fans watching around the world, people backstage. A very, very emotional night. I mean, you've probably seen a fair few Jushin Thunder Liger matches on the TV, and possibly one or two as a fan. I know he's been a regular coming over here to wrestle for independent promotions around the UK in the past. But what's your kind of thoughts, and what's going to be your lasting memory of Jushin Thunder Liger, the man that you know anyway?
I think it has to be said he's the greatest junior heavyweight wrestler of all time. I think the only person that comes close is Rey Mysterio Jr. But yeah, I think Jushin changed the business when he came over into WCW as part of that. He transcended the sport, essentially, and it was always great seeing him come over to the UK, because essentially it's somebody that I shouldn't get to see live, and whenever Liger was on a show, I'd try and get to it. If it's like 3-4 hours travel or something down to London, I'd do it. And I remember one of the Global War shows, I think it might be in like 2015, 2016, he was wrestling on there. One night he was wrestling in Will Ospreay. And so I got to get a picture with like the legendary Thunder Liger, which is always surreal in itself. And yeah, I think there's not much more I can say. Is when you talk about the greatest of all time, especially in the junior division, Liger's in that discussion.
Yeah, definitely. Totally agree. And it's one of my big regrets as a wrestling fan that I never got a chance to see him wrestle live. But there's tons and tons of archive footage of Jushin Thunder Liger, whether it's on New Japan World or on YouTube or wherever. But he featured in the very first match, so I think that a lot of people were quite surprised to see him open the show. But that they do say the old adage is, if you don't close the show, it's best to open it and kind of get the show off with a bang. And they certainly did get it off with a bang. It was an 8-man tag, and it was featuring kind of legends and past opponents, past foes and past partners that have featured in Jushin Thunder Liger matches over the last 30 years. And the first match. Now, I might need a bit of help with one or two of these names, Kurt, but you had Aneko Sano, who's a longtime rival of Jushin Thunder Liger, Shinjiro Otani, who I do remember from the early 90s, having some classic battles with Jushin Thunder Liger in the Best of the Super Junior tournaments. Tatsuhito Takawa, I think that's right, and Taguchi, and they were cornered by Kobayashi, who was originally going to be part of the match, but I think he decided that it'd be better off if he was a corner man. And then in Jushin Thunder Liger's team, you obviously had Liger along with Tiger Mask. Now, I'm not sure what version of Tiger Mask this is, but and then you had the great Suzuki and Tatsumi Fujinami. And Fujinami also had his battles in the US in the late 80s and early 90s. And I remember that match that he had with Ric Flair on one of the WCW pay-per-views from about 91. And they were cornered by El Samurai. So you got... 10 legends here around the ring, 8 in the ring, 2 corner men. Now, this match featured, as I mentioned, various partners and opponents of the legendary Jushin Thunder Liger throughout his career. And as you can imagine, Liger received a thunderous ovation, a massive pop from the 40,000 people in the Tokyo Dome when he made his entrance. None of these veterans missed a beat, though, and it brought back so many great memories of watching these 8 men fly around the ring as if it was the 1990s all over again. However, the end of the match ended in quite shocking fashion, to be honest with you, or maybe not, to be honest with you. Jushin Thunder Liger taking the pin thanks to a tiger facebuster from Taguchi. And you could say that, you know, Liger was kind of taking the pinfall as a sign of respect to his opponents. But he did lose here in the opening match, or the first of 2 retirement matches for Liger. There was a huge amount of respect for Jushin Thunder Liger after the match, with all of Liger's teammates and opponents bowing and shaking hands with Liger after the match. What were your thoughts on this opener to Wrestle Kingdom 14 then, Kurt?
To be honest, I enjoyed it. I think it needed to be on first, because none of these matches of Liger's were going to be in-ring stealing the show. So I think opening up won't have it compared to anything else, and people would just be able to enjoy it for what it is. And yeah, I really liked it. Seeing all these different legends, like, there's such nostalgia. But like you said earlier, they could still go, because a lot of these are still wrestling, whether it's in like 01 or other places in Japan. And like Fujinami, like seeing the dragon in the ring again was fantastic. Like I said, the innovators of the sport, they're the reason why we know wrestling how it is today. And I thought it was a nice touch that on each of their entrance videos, it was showing different stuff of their involvement with Jushin Thunder Liger as well.
That was great. It really was great. And like I say, so much respect paid towards Jushin Thunder Liger. Was you surprised that he took the pinfall loss?
No. I think there's so much respect and honour for Liger that I think he was always going to go out on his back and give the win to... And with Taguchi getting the win, he's the only one that's still wrestling in New Japan. And I think I guess it's the right decision. Yes, it'd have been nice to see Liger get the win, but again, it would do nothing for Taguchi. So,
yeah, doing the honourable thing on the way out.
Yeah.
But then we went into another 8-man tag, and the first team was featuring Sanada, Evil, Shingo Takagi, and Bushi versus Suzuki Gun, featuring Zack Sabre Jr., Minoru Suzuki, Tachi, and El Desperado. So it was a pretty full-on match. It was quite an enjoyable match, but Sabre Jr. and Sanada mixed up in a bit of a preview to their match for the British heavyweight title, which was going to be featured on night 2 of Wrestle Kingdom, with Sabre Jr. nearly getting the pinfall victory thanks to a roll-up fairly early on. The match didn't go too much longer, though, Kurt, with Zack Sabre Jr. He made Bushi submit with a devastating umeplata. And even after the match, ZSJ kept the hold on until Sanada came in with some stiff kicks to break up the hold and kind of making us anticipate their match for the British Heavyweight Championship even more on night 2. But this match was kind of more of a setup for night 2, in my opinion. But what did you think of this one then, Kurt?
I think he said it all there, to be honest. I think it was just a setup. It didn't really do much for me, to be honest. I think everybody already had that anticipation for ZSJ and Sanada for night two. And
it was quite a short match as well. It didn't go too long. I think it was well under 10 minutes.
Yeah, and like I said earlier, with it being two shows, it makes the quality of the shows, I won't say lacking, but it's not belt like match to match, like 5-star matches.
Yeah.
But I think it was a case of, with it being split, it was easy to digest.
Yeah, I'd agree with that.
I think.
Yeah.
But yeah, it was good ZSJ getting the win over Bushi and showing his heel tactics and stuff. But again, I could have done without the match, and I wouldn't have been complaining if I hadn't have had it, I say.
Yeah. It was more of a filler match, to be honest with you. And like I say, it helped to set up Sanada and Zack Sabre Jr.'s match for the British Heavyweight Championship for night two, more than doing anything for the actual eight-man tag match itself. Speaking of eight-man tags, we get our third eight-man tag of the night, and this time featuring the foursome from Chaos. You had Goto, you had Ishii, Yano, and Yoshihashi versus the Bullet Club, Kenta, Bad Luck Fale, Takahashi, and Chase Owens. So we get another preview of a match that's going to be taking place on night two, with Kenta being on the opposite side to Goto, and of course they're going to be going head to head with Kenta's never open weight championship on the line in night two. Takahashi gets a close near fall in this one from a brainbuster before Bad Luck Fale gets a suplexed by Goto before Goto hits Takahashi with his GTR for the 1-2-3 and the win for his team. So this match was probably, you know, about the same as the first match, really. It was a lot of fun. Everyone got their moves in. But like I say, very similar to the previous eight-man tag, this was very much a match that was setting up the Never Open Weight Championship match for night two between Kenta and Goto. Any thoughts on this eight-man tag before we move on to some of the championship matches?
I preferred it. In the notes that I put down when I was watching, I felt it built more anticipation for Goto and Kenta than the previous did for ZSJ and Sanada. I think it was always, you had that anticipation of when them two lock horns in that match, and then when they did, it was just a taste of what's to come in night two. So yeah, again, a typical eight man that you see on the road twos from New Japan, but I think this one built the anticipation better than the previous match.
It was good. But like I say, those two eight-man tags, they probably wouldn't have been missed if they weren't on the card, but they were there to serve a purpose. But then the card seemed to pick up quite a bit, and I really enjoyed the next match, and it was for the IWGP Heavyweight Tag Team Championships between the Gorillas of Destiny, Tama Tonga and Tangaloa, who were the current champions going into the match, going up against Finjuice, David Finlay and Juice Robinson, and they are the current World Tag League champions. So this match started on the rampway as Robinson and Finlay met the current champions during the entrance, with Robinson almost regretting his actions immediately after getting backdropped quite heavily on the hard rampway. David Finlay was disposed off the side of the ramp. G.O.D. hit their magic killer on Finlay, with Robinson breaking up the pinfall attempt. G.O.D. then attempted a super power bomb from the top, but Finlay managed to transition this move into a Hurricane Rana. Juice Robinson hits his Pulp Fiction on Tangaloa, allowing David Finlay to drop Tangaloa with Tama Tonga with his sliced bread for the pinfall victory. And the World Tag League champions now become the IWGP Heavyweight Tag Team Champions of the World. So this was a step up. This was a really good match. The fans were really into the action. There's plenty of drama. It's a really good tag team action in this one, with Finjuice fighting back to overcome the odds against one of the biggest and best names in New Japan tag history. We have new heavyweight tag team champions in New Japan. So a really good match. Juice Robinson, David Finlay, the new tag team champions. Juice Robinson did seem to kind of suffer with a bit of a back injury. I think that was probably from the kind of opening segment of moves where he got backdropped on the rampway, which looked really painful. I enjoyed this one. What about yourself, Kurt?
Yeah, it was really good. It was something different. Like you said, G.O.D. are one of the best IWGP World Tag Team Champions of all time.
Definitely.
And New Japan's tag division is just non-existent at the moment, if I'm being honest. Like, the only thing that you have is, let's have G.O.D. against Evil and Sanada, or it's like recycled tag matches. So having this was something fresh. I think it was something that New Japan had in mind for a while, because if you remember, Juice Robinson and David Finlay was originally both supposed to be in Lifeblood over in Ring of Honor. And it's good to see that, although that didn't work out for numerous reasons, which we won't get into, at least it's something fresh. And I think it's great for David Finlay. Like, this is his first like big opportunity, I think, with Juice as his partner. And it'll be interesting to see what G.O.D. do next. I imagine there'll be a rematch eventually, but hopefully Finn Juice can keep it on them for a while. And whilst they've got the titles, maybe build more tag teams up rather than just feeding them to G.O.D.
Yeah, totally agree. And then the commentary team mentioned that Juice Robinson could himself be a double champion after night two, as he will be taking on the winner of the next match, Lance Archer versus John Moxley, for Archer's IWGP United States Championship. And both of them matches, the one that's about to come up, Lance Archer versus John Moxley and Robinson versus the winner, will no doubt be fantastic matches. But let's get into Lance Archer versus John Moxley. So Moxley still picking up the dates with New Japan, despite the fact he signed with AEW. Now, I know you put out a post on the ringsider.co.uk website yesterday asking the kind of the question post-match whether there could be, you know, a possible relationship between AEW and New Japan. Without giving away kind of the end to this match, kind of give us a bit more insight into your thoughts there, Kurt, because obviously, you know, and then in night two, you've got Jericho, the current AEW world champion, and mystical portal that he describes as possibly being opened if he were to lose his match, leaving the AEW world title open to a New Japan competitor. So, you know, there could be something there, but give us your thoughts on AEW New Japan, whether there could be a working relationship there, if not now, sometime in the future.
I think it's building trust again, obviously. I think especially Kenny leaving hurt New Japan.
Not just
the product, but I think a lot of people that have been hurt personally. I asked the question because obviously Moxley's gone back out there to challenge for the United States Championship. And at the time, not knowing what happens in night two or anything like that, I was like, well, if Moxley picks up the win, their United States champion is contracted to AEW. And because of that, Moxley cannot work any American dates for New Japan. And in 2020, it's been announced, well, New Japan are expanding. They're wanting to open like the American branch, essentially.
Yeah.
How do you do that when your US champion can't work for you? Because he's working for another company. That was kind of the way I'm going with, like, if they're going to put the trust in Moxley to hold the title, or if they're not, is this going to be the baby steps? And like you mentioned with Jericho, like, AEW title shot on the line if Tanahashi beats him. Is this all just testing the waters without making anything official, seeing if they can play nicely together before becoming in a friendship?
I think that could be it. But like I say, I'm in agreement with you. I don't think anything's been signed on the dotted line yet. But just testing the waters. And I think that trust probably will build again, especially with their, you know, having Moxley on AEW and New Japan cards, and the same with Jericho. I think that trust has to rebuild, and I think that those two individuals will help rebuild the trust between AEW and New Japan, regardless of what's happened in the past. But I think it makes sense for both companies, to be honest with you. And like I say, with New Japan doing more work over in the States through 2020 and beyond, it makes sense to kind of have a relationship between a company that has some of its stars working for it. But let's get stuck into Archer versus Moxley then. So going into this match, Kurt, what was your kind of expectations? What were your thoughts? I know that you've spoken to Lance Archer in a Wrestle Thoughts pod interview back last year. He's a big guy going up against John Moxley. He's got a reputation as being a tough, badass wrestler. And of course, he's the number one contender for the AEW World Championship as well. But John Moxley never actually lost the United States champion in New Japan. It got vacated, and of course Lance Archer went up against Juice Robinson to win the title a couple of months back. But what were your thoughts going into this one, buddy?
It was one of the matches I was most excited for, to be honest. Like you mentioned with Wrestle Thoughts, like that will be getting re-released as like a ringside as a vault, and what we're going to be working on. But in that one, it was just fresh out of his G1 and was like, right, what's next? Because at that point, and he still isn't, despite being the US champion going into Wrestle Kingdom, he isn't under a contract with New Japan. So if Impact Wrestling, NWA, WWE, or AEW came knocking, they could lose Archer, which baffles me, especially after the G1. After that G1, surely you just secure him down. And I was speaking like, what's next? Maybe a singles run, because we're speaking about him reinventing himself, wanting to get out of the image of being a tag team wrestler. And at that time, Moxley was the United States champion. I was like, how about it? Maybe at a Wrestle Kingdom, you, Moxley, United States champion. And he mentioned he'd love to get in the ring with Moxley and that they'd be able to cause some damage with each other. And then Moxley, obviously, got stripped. It was like, maybe Moxley's done in New Japan now. And then out of nowhere, he's returning. He's like, right, actually, you've got my belt. I want that. And the match that we discussed is kind of is happening, but in the roles reversed, Archer going in there as champion and Moxley being the person fighting for it. And with the addition of a Texas Death match, like, it was everything for both of them to showcase, like, what they can do. And again, Lance Archer just came out looking like a megastar, and New Japan need to lock him up before the losing.
Yeah, they really do. But he looks like an absolute beast in this match. And John Moxley, just whenever you see him on the screen post WWE, just looks like a different guy, looks like an animal, like he's ready for any type of fight. But this match goes to the outside pretty early with a suicide dive from Moxley. Archer throws a chair into the face of Moxley before utilising trash can lids and a couple of kendo stick shots. Archer then destroys Mox with a blackout through four chairs in the centre of the ring, but Mox manages to beat the ref's 10 count. Archer even pulls a plastic bag out to try to suffocate Moxley, which wasn't illegal in this match. Being a Texas Death match, pretty much anything goes. Archer sets up two tables in the outside and attempts to put Moxley through with another blackout. However, Mox fought his way out of the move to drive Archer through both tables with his paradigm shift DDT. Moxley managed to get to his feet to beat the referee's 10 count just in the nick of time, and we have a new two-time United States champion after this brilliant but brutal Texas Death match. Archer appeared to slice his arm open on that table spot, but now we have Moxley versus Juice Robinson to settle their score with the United States Championship on the line for night two. So give us your thoughts on the match. I loved it, and I think I mentioned to you earlier that I thought this was possibly my favourite match of the night, certainly at this point anyway in the card. But how about yourself?
Yeah, at this point in the card, best match hands down, and it was great. Like, I am really happy for Archer. Moxley, I just love watching everything he does. It's like a complete different person. And I really like that carrier bag bit. I thought that is brutal, doing his Iron Claw, famous by the Von Erichs, but with the plastic bag. I thought that was quite a good touch, and that was how I was like,
never seen that before, Kurt. Never seen a plastic bag being utilised in that way.
No, me neither. And I thought Moxley was done for at that point. I was like, actually, this is clever. You're using Archer's finisher with the addition of a plastic bag, and that's how you destroy beat Moxley. That way, keep him strong. But no, Moxley managed to get out of it. He even took he had Archer's helmet, which had spikes going out, like, hammered into the top of his face, which essentially made him bleed before the paradigm shift through the tables. And yeah, really enjoyed it. It was a really good showing. Hopefully Archer gets locked down, or if not, somebody else will lock him down. And yeah, Moxley, two-time United States champion, and he'll be facing Juice. And can Juice become the double champ before whoever wins the IWGP and IC title?
Yeah, precisely. And the other thing I loved about this this Texas Death Match was it's not your typical New Japan style match, to be honest with you, but the fans absolutely ate it up. They loved it. And like I say, I just loved seeing John Moxley in a New Japan ring again, which was something we possibly thought we wouldn't see ever again. But that leads us nicely to the next championship match. Will Ospreay, the current IWGP Junior Heavyweight Champion, going up against Hiromu Takahashi. So in this match, Ospreay is going into Wrestle Kingdom and 2020 is the man with the most amount of five-star matches from 2019, according to the Wrestling Observer. I think he had five-star matches under his belt from the last 12 months. Ospreay gets a close near fall following a double foot stomp and a draping DDT on Takahashi. Ospreay attempts a Sasuke special but misses, landed on his feet on the outside. Ospreay then avoids a German suplex, kind of landed on his feet almost in a backflip, before diving or kind of running back into the ring, attempting a second Sasuke special, which he nails this time. And that was a brilliant sequence of moves from Ospreay. I mean, just looking at that sequence of moves and what Ospreay did there, it's already turned itself into kind of a viral meme. But Ospreay is just like no other wrestler on the earth at the moment. Wouldn't you agree with me there?
Yeah, in the Ringsiders like yearly awards that we did, I actually voted myself, and I'd put down Will Ospreay for my Wrestler of the Year. I think what he's done in 2019 has been absolutely incredible. And the spot that you mentioned, one of the things I want to bring up is normally when people do these dives, the wrestlers are just stood there waiting and never move out the way. And you're like, why wouldn't you move out the way? And when Ospreay misses the first Sasuke special, it was because Hiromu saw him coming and took a step back so that Ospreay had missed the landing, and then he could get him into the attempts for the German suplex. And I thought that was, it's those little things that made that sequence so perfect.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, absolutely. But the match didn't end there. Ospreay springboards himself from one side of the corner post to the other with a wicked double foot stomp to the back of Takahashi's head. Takahashi nearly had the match won himself with an avalanche destroyer from the top. And again, he's a dynamite plunger. There's another close near fall from an Ospreay Oscutter. By this point, Ospreay must have been wondering what he had to do to put Hiromu Takahashi away. The referee kind of pulls a three count from a Takahashi time bomb. He kind of really delayed that three count, but the fans were really biting on that one. Takahashi finally wins the match with a new move, a spiked sidewalk bomb, which I think he's calling the time bomb two, to become the new IWGP Junior Heavyweight Champion in this incredible, incredible match. I enjoyed the hell out of this one, and might well get Will Ospreay another five-star rating from Mr. Dave Meltzer, but gives your overall thoughts on this Junior Heavyweight Championship match?
It was incredible, and part of me couldn't enjoy it if it was a different person than Hiromu. Like, I kept cringing anything that was to the back of the head or the neck. Obviously, Hiromu coming back from the broken neck injury, and Ospreay ended up doing the Hidden Blade, which seemed absolutely brutal. And I remember like cringing at that bit. But yeah, the match itself was absolutely incredible, and Hiromu picks up the gold. He's taking the IWP Junior Heavyweight title back to Los Ingobernables de Japón, and I couldn't see anything else but a Hiromu win here. It was a great fairy tale ending for him, fairy tale return for him. And yeah, Ospreay may have his first five-star match out of the year.
Most definitely. It's only the 4th of January. But give you some extra kind of thoughts on Will Ospreay, because he had an incredible 2019. You said yourself that you voted for him on your own kind of poll as Wrestler of the Year. And he was definitely voted for by many people on the Wrestling with Jonna's End of Year Awards as well. But now that he's no longer the Junior Heavyweight Champion, he's obviously made it clear of his desires to possibly be taken seriously as a heavyweight and possibly be looking as a contender for some of the heavyweight championships. What are your thoughts if he were to go up against, you know, an Intercontinental Champion, a US Champion, or maybe an IWGP Heavyweight Champion? Do you think he's ready? Do you think he's in that league yet?
Yeah, well, he's proved it. Whether it was in the New Japan Cup or the New Japan G1 Climax, he's proved that he can hang with the, let's say, big boys, with them being heavyweights. And
yeah,
his stature is, he's bigger than half the heavyweights anyways. And I think 2020 will be where everybody's asking, is Will Ospreay the best bout machine?
Definitely.
I think he's got it in him. And this year, he was in so many different tournaments. And I think if he takes a step back and think, actually, I'm leaving the junior division, I'm officially moving up to the heavyweight division, and then that way he's focusing on their single tournaments, it'll be interesting to see what sort of year he would have without burning himself out in so many tournaments. Because I believe Ospreay had the most singles matches in New Japan. Well, the most matches in New Japan, and the like minutes spent in New Japan and all over the world. Absolutely ridiculous from Ospreay.
Yeah, and the one thing that I've really noticed from Ospreay over the last couple of years, Kurt, is he really seems to have matured as a character, as a performer, as an individual, but also on the microphone when he does his backstage stuff. He really seems quite comfortable behind the microphone, whereas before, maybe going back 3 or 4 years, he probably wasn't as comfortable. And I think that's led to him being more of a rounded character, which I think is thanks to New Japan, to be honest with you, which is obviously a much more of a serious professional wrestling company. And like you say, he has turned into the more all-round total package, really, not just in the ring. And I think his ring style has changed as well, slightly, where he's not taking as many risks, and his risks are a bit more calculated, and he's more of a rounded wrestler. But behind the microphone as a character, I think he's starting to nail that as well.
Yeah, he's not trying to kill himself with every bump these days, which is good to see. And I think it's just, the maturity. We've seen it in Zack Sabre Jr., somebody who always somewhat struggled delivering promos. And now I love his promo work in New Japan. And I think it's the same with Will. Like, he's matured and he's becoming an absolute megastar.
Yeah, he really is. Speaking of megastars, we're into our semi-final match now for the IWGP Intercontinental Championship. The champion going into it, Jay White, going up against Naito. Can you pronounce Naito's first name, please, Kurt?
Tetsuya Naito.
Thank you. So this was the first match of the double gold dash, with the winner going on to main event day two, of course, to face either Okada or Ibushi for a chance to hold the IWGP heavyweight and, of course, intercontinental titles. Jay White applies a muta lock early on, with Naito managing to get to the ropes for a rope break. At one point, Jay White drops Naito hard on the ring apron from a snap Saito suplex, and that looked really, really painful. Towards the end of the match, the referee gets knocked to the ground. This allows Gedo to come in to interfere. Jay White throws a chair hard into the face of Naito before connecting with a dragon suplex and a sleeper suplex. However, Naito somehow manages to connect with a Destino, but he's too exhausted to make the cover. Naito hits two more Destinos to eventually get the three count to become the new IWGP Intercontinental Champion. And this match built and it built and it built, and eventually gave us the incredible match that we knew it would deliver. And Naito winning the Intercontinental Gold and going on to main event night two with the chance of being the double champion in the double gold dash. But this was a really, really fun match. Loved Jay White with his heel tactics, a little bit of interference from Gedo on the outside, but Naito kind of really fought and was a worthy winner. It was a great match. But what were your thoughts on this IC title match?
Yeah, I really liked it. Jay White has become a fantastic professional wrestler since taking the Switchblade moniker. But Tetsuya Naito, he's one of my favourite wrestlers in any company. It's part of the reason why I started looking properly into Los Ingobernables de Japón. I'd seen him in Rev Pro and thought, you know what, I'm going to check out more New Japan. And I kept watching matches that Naito would be in, so all these these six-man tags, eight-man tags, and I just fell in love with Los Ingobernables de Japón. They're my faction. I know everybody loves Bullet Club, but LIJ is the one that I like. And with Naito, his story's been very, very telling, to be fair. Like, He's previously held the IWGP Heavyweight Championship. This win made him a 5-time Intercontinental Champion and one of the best of all time to be holding that belt. But the story is he's been in that top spot before,
yeah,
and it didn't work out. It was as if the fans didn't like that he was in that position, which obviously is never good. And now you've seen him a couple of years later and he's so matured and the fans are backing him, and for him to be going into this double gold, it's just it's a great opportunity, and I think he needed it, and I'm so glad Naito won.
Yeah, definitely. It was a fantastic match. And then speaking of fantastic matches, we go into our main event of night one, Wrestle Kingdom 14, Kazuchika Okada versus Kota Ibushi for the IWGP Heavyweight Championship, a part two of the double dash of gold, where the winner will now face Naito in the main event of night two. So Ibushi was the first to make his entrance with his G1 Climax winning briefcase under his arm, but the entrance of the night has to go to the Rainmaker. It was always spectacular when Okada entrances, but when he does his Wrestle Kingdom entrances, they're always something special. I mean, there's an on-screen Okada, and he kind of fights a couple of mystical beasts, and then there's this puff of smoke, and Okada is there. Where he came from, nobody knows, but it's a fantastic entrance. But what were your thoughts and your expectations going into this one then, Kurt, about the match, the two individuals, the entrances? But what were your thoughts on this one going into it?
The match was mega, to be honest, and I think it's the first time where it put in doubt who's going to win. Obviously, New Japan never really pulled the plug with Kota Ibushi in the past because he was never under contract, and they was worried that if they book somebody into that position, then what happens if he's like, actually, I'm going? And Okada's the best wrestler in the world.
Yeah.
I know I said I voted for Will. I think Will had the better year, but in that ring, Okada's untouchable. But then Kota Ibushi's untouchable in his own right, in a different way. And I think them two are the ones that scream like megastars. Like I said, I love Naito. If I was to relate it to like a WWE world, I'd say he's like a Rollins or a Bryan or somebody like that. Whereas Okada is the Cena, and yeah, Ibushi could be like the Reigns, like where he's also a megastar.
Yeah.
And this match was just ridiculous.
Yeah. Well, let's go through some of the key stuff then. So the match started off quite methodically, as you would expect, but we knew the good stuff was on its way, and it did not disappoint. Okada dropped Ibushi with a draping DDT from the railings at ringside, and that looked really painful. Okada nails Ibushi again, this time drop-kicking Ibushi from off the top turnbuckle to the floor on the outside before nailing Ibushi with a huge crossbody over the railings and into the front row of the fans. Ibushi attempts a backflip kick, but lands horribly on his head. Ibushi briefly recovers to hit Okada with a bastard driver, but afterwards Ibushi just looked out of it. He looked dazed. He looked gone. Okada dropped Ibushi with a tombstone on the ring apron. Ibushi just managed to beat the referee's 20 count there. There's a second tombstone back inside the ring, but Ibushi avoids Okada's Rainmaker to hit a Rainmaker of his own. There's a stiff striking exchange between these two, and by this point they've been going nearly 30 minutes. Ibushi misses a Phoenix Splash. Okada connects with two Rainmakers, but still only a two count from the referee, and the drama at this point was at full volume. Okada hits a third Rainmaker and a fourth. Ibushi manages to avoid a fifth Rainmaker, but Okada doesn't miss a beat and drops Ibushi with a packaged tombstone before deploying a final Rainmaker, folding Ibushi up for the eventual 1-2-3. So I've got down here on my notes, wow, !! Okada retains the IWGP Heavyweight Championship. It goes on to face Tetsuya Naito for all the gold for the double gold dash in the main event of night two. And that match, it built, and it gave us that epic conclusion that you would expect from Wrestle Kingdom main events. Kurt, you said it was an epic match, but just give us your final thoughts on this main event, buddy.
It's, I'm speechless, to be honest, with how good it was.
It was that good.
it just proved that Okada is as good as everybody says he is. Ibushi, I really loved the point where he started getting booed by people because he just blanks out. He does a bit where he blanks out and then he becomes vicious and has no care and will just do careless kicks and turns quite nasty. And I really like that side of Ibushi. I think the match added layers into his character for what could transpire throughout 2020. And yeah, I don't know how they didn't break the necks a lot of the time. There was a lot of like head impact in the mats there. Obviously you mentioned the backflip kick where he kind of landed horribly on his head and Okada caught him. But yeah, really good. Really enjoyed it. And now we're going to get Okada and Naito.
Yeah, so what a main event that's going to be. But a great night one of Wrestle Kingdom 14. Like I say, the eight-man tags, they were there to serve a purpose. They were shorter. The match quality wasn't that great, but they were there to serve a purpose, so obviously build into championship matches on night two. But overall, I thought that Wrestle Kingdom night one was a massive success. The fans loved every minute of it. But not only that, I think it also proved that you can have Wrestle Kingdom spread over 2 days, because night one, not only does it serve a purpose in delivering some fantastic, tremendous matches, as we saw from the kind of the center point of the card all the way through to the main event, but it also helps to continue storylines and to build towards matches that are going to take place the next night. So I think doing it over 2 days on the whole was a massive success. Now, we can't talk about night two until the podcast I'm going to be recording later on today, Kurt, but would you agree with my sentiments there?
Yeah, it was. Show one was fantastic, but it still left you wanting more.
Exactly.
And you knew you was getting more, and now I feel fulfilled. Yeah, I'll still be watching New Year Dash, and yeah, it was incredible. The show was absolutely fantastic. Night two was just as incredible, and I'll be looking forward to like hearing your thoughts on that one. And yeah, I'm just glad to see that it's Okada and Naito in the main event. Obviously, they've had a storied past in the past. I think it was back in Wrestle Kingdom 8, I think it was, where it was the first time that the IWGP title wasn't in the main event. And I think a lot of that got put on Naito not being big enough, or and he was facing Okada and lost. But then they'd gone back together at, you saw it at 2012, they then headlined Wrestle Kingdom. And again, Okada coming out on top of a Naito. So it's interesting to see how the main event will play out. And it's just, I'm glad Naito's back in the main event picture.
And some other fantastic matches that we have to look forward to on night two. You've obviously got the second and final retirement match from Juicy and Thunder Liger. You've obviously got the championship match pitting Zack Sabre Jr. versus Sonata for the Rev Pro British Heavyweight Championship. You've got Kenta going up against Goto for the Nevira Openweight Championship. Juice Robinson taking on John Moxley. Of course, the fantastic main event that we alluded to. Chris Jericho, the current AEW World Champion. He'll be taking on Tanahashi. And that's an incredible match. No championships on the line in that one. However, he has said that if Tanahashi can beat him, that could possibly lead to a future AEW World Championship shot for him somewhere down the line. So we'll have to see whether that becomes a reality. But yeah, so many fantastic matches to look forward to. And of course, the two losers of the double gold dash matches will face each other in Jay White and Kota Ibushi as well. So another fantastic match to look forward to on night two. So it's going to be a stacked night two. Any other matches you're particularly looking forward to from night two of Wrestle Kingdom, Kurt?
I think the main ones, Sabre Jr. and Sonata is always good. I saw them challenge for the British Heavyweight Championship back in maybe September, October time. It was at Ungovernable in Manchester for Rev Pro, and that was fantastic. So, yeah, this match I'm really looking forward to. Obviously, you've got Moxley and Juice finishing their career, and I think every match I was looking forward to, but it's that main event, Naito, Okada, who's going to be making history.
Definitely. It's all about who's going to be carrying all the gold at the end of it. But Kurt, I want to thank you so much for helping us cover Wrestle Kingdom Day 1 on the Wrestling with Jonathan podcast. Thank you so much. And I hope you enjoy Wrestle Kingdom Day 2. Thanks for coming on board, buddy.
Yeah, thank you for having me. I always enjoy coming on and talking wrestling. And like I said at the start of it, it was part of the reason why I did Kurt's angle. So yeah, thank you for having me.
You're very welcome, and I would love to get you back on the podcast sometime in the near future. But that's pretty much it from me, and pretty much it for our review of Wrestle Kingdom 14 Day 1. We'll be covering Day 2, which will be dropping Sunday the 5th of January, so later on this afternoon as we speak. And I'll be joined by somebody that's been on the podcast before, Grizz, who's one of our Facebook followers. And he's a big New Japan fan, and he'll be helping us to cover all of the action from Day 2 of Wrestle Kingdom 14. As I mentioned at the top of the show, don't forget to check out our new website, wrestlingwithjonas.com, where you've got all of our social media links, all of our archive to our podcasts and video casts, vlogs, interviews, news articles, and so much more. Please keep it tuned to the Wrestling with Jonas podcast for all of your weekly NXT and AEW updates, including regular WWE and AEW pay-per-view reviews, and so much more. And if you've enjoyed listening to the podcast, please don't forget to spread the word. Tell your friends and tell your family. And don't forget to subscribe to the Wrestling with Jonas podcast so you don't miss out on a single episode. But that's pretty much it from this episode. Thank you to Kurt one final time for helping us review Wrestle Kingdom 14 Day 1. And we'll catch up with you all again very, very soon.
Bye for now.